St. John in the Wilderness on this beautiful fall morning. I hope you've had a chance to enjoy these wonderful colors that we have. Maybe go on a drive this week up to the parkway. What a beautiful place to live in this corner here in God's creation. If you are new or visiting, I'd like to welcome you. I'm Father Josh Stevens, the rector here. We'd love to get to know you better. You can fill out a card that you'll find in the pew there and put it in the offering plate, and we'll be in touch with you in the week that's ahead. You'll also find in the pews, there's the colorful cards. If you'd like to offer to God an offering of time and talent from this week, a moment in which you were able to offer of yourself or sense God's presence, feel free to write that down and put it in the offering plate. A few other announcements as we look ahead. We did just have formation. We'll continue to talk about cultivating the fruits of the Spirit in adult formation at the 10 o'clock hour next week, so join us for that. We also, today at 4 o'clock, we have our Friends of Music concert in the parish hall. So we hope you'll join us for this monthly concert. They'll be playing some pop music, some really fun tunes that many of you will be familiar with. So there'll be some singing and just enjoying.
Not maybe.
There are definitely, I'm hoping, you know, Let It Be or Hey Jude or something. Yeah, so.
Take me home, country road.
Take me home. That is a good one to sing, especially this time of year. So join us at 4 o'clock today for this concert, an hour that you'll really enjoy. We'll see you there at the parish hall. We also have All Saints Sunday coming, a feast day, major feast of the church, the first Sunday in November. So we look forward to that. We'll have a baptism that Sunday as well. You'll hear us pray for Nick Stevens and his family in the prayers of the people. Not related to me, but they do have the good sense to spell the name properly, with a PH. Nick and Laura and Adam are back there, so we're looking forward to that that time on All Saints Sunday. On All Souls Day is November 2nd. We started a service a few years ago that we'd invite you to this year, 4 o'clock on November 2nd. We'll read the names aloud of those who have died in the year prior, or a loved one that you'd like to have their name read aloud. So we like to do it outside. If the weather's too cold, we'll move it inside. November 2nd at 4 o'clock. We moved it back an hour, so 4 p.m. And if you want to submit a name, do that this week in the email or call the office so we can read your loved one's name as part of that service. I think that about covers it. Is there anything else I might be forgetting for now? Okay. Such a gift to be gathered with you all for church this morning. And to that end, why don't we stand as we sing All My Hope on God is Founded. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
God, in Christ you have revealed your glory among the nations. Preserve the works of your mercy, that your church throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in the confession of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped, subdue nations before him and strip kings of their robes, to open doors before him and the gates shall not be closed. I will go before you and level the mountains. I will break into pieces the doors of bronze, cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and riches hidden in secret places, so that you may know that it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who call you by your name. For the sake of my servant Jacob and Israel, my chosen, I call you by your name. I surname you, though you do not know me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I arm you, though you do not know me, so that they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is no one besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make weal and create woe. I, the Lord, do all these things. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Sing to the Lord.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Thessalonians. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the Church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace. We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers, constantly remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love, and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, beloved by God, that he has chosen you, because our message of the gospel came to you, not in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit, and with full conviction, just as you know what kind of persons we proved to be among you for your sake. And you became imitators of us and of the Lord. For in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions report about us what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. The word of the Lord.
And teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax. They brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, Whose head is this? And whose title? They answered, The emperor's. Then he said to them, Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's. When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Grace to you and peace. This or that. Who is right? Who is wrong? Who wins? These are big questions these days. Wars are fought amongst friends, lovers, spouses, and nations about this or that. Who is right? Who is wrong? Have you ever been in a fight? I hope you haven't. Be peaceful, friends, but I reckon that many of you have, like I have, been in a fight. Maybe you haven't ever been in a physical confrontation with another human being, but I think it's safe to say that every single person in this church has at least been in an argument with somebody else. What did that look like for you? Was it sudden, or did you get ready for it? Like me, you might have even known that the fight was coming. We see the signs. It's been building. That person said or did that thing, and we're just not going to take it anymore. The symphony of tumult has built itself to the point of a crescendo. That person has, excuse my language, kids, you can do this if you want to, that person has pissed us off. We feel that this person has wronged us, and that person is about to get a piece of our mind. Or fist, or whatever. If you've ever been in a fight or an argument, I reckon that you, like me, have it kind of all planned out in your head. I'm going to walk right up to that SOB or child of God, kind of, you know, same thing. And I'm going to give that person peace of my mind. If, like me, when we get ready for a fight or an argument, we have planned it out so much in our heads that we may even have like a song playing in our mind when we walk towards that person at the other end of our anger. We can picture like the West Side Story with the Jets and the Sharks. You know it. You know the story. Or we can listen to James Brown's song, The Big Payback. He's mad. And I'm mad. And you're mad. You are mad and someone is about to hear all about it. When we get angry at another person and it is time to tell them all about it, we build ourselves up. And God help the person who we are about to give the business to. Now, I doubt that the Pharisees of Jesus' day had James Brown or the West Side Story in their playlist
as they prepared to go confront Jesus, which would be a really cool picture, actually. But the same human feeling was there. They wanted to fight, and they had planned exactly what they wanted to say. This Jesus, this simple carpenter from a little town in the wilderness, had caught them off guard. He had used ancient scripture, their words, to fling mud in their faces. He had challenged their power. Now, obviously, the Pharisees, like I said, didn't listen to James Brown, but I still like to picture these folks incensed, walking towards where Jesus was teaching with the idea that they would give him the big payback, blasting loud in their headphones. They are angry, they are fearful, and perhaps a bit embarrassed. They're looking for some Jesus payback. What they aren't counting on is getting paid back. We find ourselves in a place in our journey through Scripture where Jesus has been going hard in the paint, to use the language of our younger folk. Jesus is going after, he is hitting the establishment, the religious leaders, sitting hard. It's Holy Week in today's gospel. Jesus rides into town and goes to the temple where he drives out the merchants and overthrows the money changers' tables. Then he calls everybody a bunch of thieves. To make matters worse, he heals the lame and blind in the temple. His words, his actions, really make the chief priests and the scribes very, very angry. Who do you think you are? By what authority are you doing these things, they ask him. But he doesn't answer them. Instead, he says that they are like disobedient children, worse than the very people they judge and condemn as disobedient. And he doesn't stop there. He tells them a story about tenants of a vineyard who steal from the landlord and murder his son. They realize that he is not talking about tenants of a vineyard. He is talking about them. They decide that they're going to get him. They want to arrest him, but they are afraid of the crowds. And to their chagrin, Jesus is on a roll. He knows that they are mad, but instead of fighting with them, he tells them another story. This one is about a wedding banquet, the kind that they would be invited to. But the story doesn't end the way that they would expect it to. One of the guests gets tied up and thrown into the outer darkness, where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. They know that this story is about them, and it doesn't end well. And now they're really mad. Enough is enough. The religious leaders about whom Jesus is speaking plot how they can trap Jesus. Things are so bad that they bring in the Herodians as co-conspirators. They join forces with the party that supports Rome's domination of their own people. Because politics and anger and fear are a dangerous combination that makes for unlikely alliances. They start with flattery. We know that you are true and teach the way of God in accordance with truth and show deference to no one. They're buttering him up, hoping Jesus will let down his guard. What do you think? They ask. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? Now, as a person who almost became a lawyer, preacher, and also a person who is an avid lover of crime novels, I have to say that I love the question that they propose to Jesus. It's a wonderfully crafted question, meant to trap this nuisance publicly, shutting him up so that things would go back to the way things ought to be. They plotted to entrap Jesus in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" Now, if Jesus says yes, he risks offending and losing his followers and all those for whom Roman taxation is a daily reminder that they are dominated by a foreign power in their land. If he says no, he risks being charged with insurrection and treason. And Rome's supporters, the Herodians, are there as witnesses. Now we've got to understand, friends, that this question is not about taxes. It's not about the government. It's not about Roman occupation of the Jews or the separation of church and state. It's about an agenda. The Pharisees and the Herodians don't care what the answer is, because either way, they've got it. And we are asked to consider similar questions on a daily basis. Now, the questions may be different, but the Pharisaic-Herodian conspiracy is still a part of our world today. It's played out every time we oversimplify complex issues, when we categorize people, we pigeonhole parts of our lives and try to manipulate Jesus. Is homosexuality lawful? Say yes and you will be labeled a revisionist, a progressive who denies the authority of Holy Scripture. Say no and you will be accused of being homophobic, prejudiced, and denying the gospel's message of love and inclusivity. Is abortion permissible? Say yes and you will be seen as supporting the killing of babies, one who ignores the commandment against murder. Say no, and you contradict a woman's right to determine what she can do with her own body. Do you support America's military involvement throughout the world, in Ukraine, in Israel? Say no, and you will be seen as anti-Semitic, unpatriotic, unsympathetic, and a hateful person. Say yes, and you have to answer for the violence, death, and destruction that seems so contrary to Jesus' life and teaching. What Hamas did to the human beings of Israel, attacking, kidnapping, murdering innocent human beings, children, is evil. And the Palestinian people are struggling. There are 2 million people in the Gaza Strip. Half of that population is under the age of 18. The Gaza Strip is sometimes referred to as the largest prison in the world, and that is also wrong. We know this, and we have to hold all of that knowledge in tension. And what are we to do with it all? It is a question that does not offer an obvious answer. And I think that is probably because the answer to these impossible questions isn't a this or that type of question, and I believe that Jesus sees a different answer to a this or that type of question. In whatever form it takes, the Pharisaic-Herodian conspiracy is about power. It's about manipulation. It is about agendas. That always destroys relationships and undermines faith. Now, sadly, that is all too evident today in our political and economic systems, as well as in our churches. Jesus, however, will not allow himself to be used, to be manipulated or co-opted by anyone, the Pharisees, the Herodians, or us. He asks the question, whose image is on the tax form? The emperor's, they answer. Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's. Now, if I had been a lawyer rather than a priest, I reckon that in trial I would stand up and say, objection, your honor. The answer is unresponsive. The question calls for a yes or no answer. Yet Jesus refuses to play that game. He doesn't answer their question, at least not in the way that they want him to. Instead, he deepens the question and turns it into a question of faith and life. If the coin belongs to the emperor, then the human being belongs to God. Each has been marked with the image of its owner. The coin, which bore the image of Tiberius with the inscription, Caesar Augustus Tiberius, son of the divine Augustus, belongs to him, the emperor. And yet we have been coined in the image of God. Now there's a little red book in your pew in front of you. It's called the Book of Common Prayer. We like that thing. And right around page 300 of the Book of Common Prayer, we have Holy Baptism. You can look at it, I promise. Now, as the Book of Common Prayer says, we have been sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. And that bond is indissoluble. So knowing this, what does faithfulness look like in the issues with which you struggle? It's a hard question. One that is answered neither easily nor quickly. For most of us, it is the work of a lifetime. Jesus does not offer simple yes or no type answers. So why should we? Faithfulness demands more than that. It means that we are continually learning to pay back, to surrender, and to render to God ourselves and one another. How will you do that for yourselves, for those you love, your neighbor, and your enemy? The key, the answer, it seems to me, is knowing to whom we belong. It's one of those answers, however, that cannot be told or taught, only experienced and learned. Faithfulness is more about struggle and practice than it is an answer. It is done at the depths of our image. Get the image right, and most everything else will follow. There will always be issues to address: taxes, economics, church-state relationships, war, homosexuality, abortion, capital punishment, personal finances, marriage, children. The list will go on and on and on. Some are global, while others are more local and personal. The danger is that in dealing with the issues, we sometimes deny, confuse, or forget in whose image we and the other have been coined in. Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's. Jesus is not separating the secular and the sacred, the spirit and matter, divine and human. He is inviting us to hold them intention, to unite the two, and in doing so, become the currency of God's life in the world. Jesus stumped the Pharisees and Herodians in our gospel lesson today. Next up are the Sadducees. He doesn't fall into their trap either. In the same chapter from the gospel according to Matthew that we just heard from today, Jesus offers the answer to the question of this or that. He says to them, he says to all of us, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as you love yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and all the prophets. So when we are asked the question, this or that, may we always respond as our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, does. The answer is love. Amen.
Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father,
the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made a man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
With all our heart and all our mind, let us pray to the Lord that God's will may be done on earth as it is in heaven. Be with your church across time and space, that our divisions may cease and that the love we share with each other and all people will bring Christ to the world. We offer thanks for those who minister in this place, for our Good News Gardeners, our Finance Committee and Endowment Trustees, our Communications and Publicity Committee, for Christian Formation and our Ministry of Sustainability, and for all who serve this parish family. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide our clergy, Josh, Ian and Sandy, and our associate clergy, Joyce, Patricia, and Stephen, and be with Jose, our bishop, Michael, our presiding bishop, and Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Speak to the people of this land and all nations, that leaders can learn to serve, and that each of us can learn to listen to you as we love one another. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for our enemies and those who wish us harm. Reconcile us to each other and grow in us a love for peace as only you can give. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Inspire us to respond to the needs of the poor, the sick, the lonely, and the afraid. Help us to respect the dignity of every human being. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the needs of this parish family. We pray for Nick Stevens and the Stevens family as they prepare for Nick's baptism on All Saints Sunday. Be with those who are grieving, and we ask you to bring comfort and healing to those on our parish prayer list. For Christopher, Bonnie, Jan, Joanne, Dottie, Tom and Anna, Jean, Loretta, Betsy, Jim, Margaret, Lee, Stephen, Jane, Catherine, Carol, Terry, Patty, John, Francis, Charles, Susan, Sally, and Pam. Are there others? Lord, in your mercy, we commend to you all who have died, especially Shelby White and Lorraine Holman. That your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy.
O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Sing a new song and rejoice.
is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament, and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let's eat in peace. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on Him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
blood of Christ covers salvation. Blood of Christ covers salvation. Blood of Christ covers salvation.
Strength and courage to love and serve.
God which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you this day and remain with you always.